All right, everyone, go ahead and have your seat. We're going to get started. We got some missionaries that we want to bring before you and let you know what they're doing. We go to a lot of camp meetings, revival meetings, and that sort of thing, and I'm for it. I love it. Around here, we will start the countdown to the 2018 Jubilee on Thursday. And we will start praying for it. We'll start preparing for it. I think I was sitting down with Pastor Smith this morning, and we weren't working on 2018. We were working on 2019 Jubilee. So we love this meeting. But one of the things that we really love about it is all the missionaries that come in. And I know that there are many of you that have been here over the years. I see Brother Zane back there. I love that when he showed up this year again, and I just see all these familiar faces. And what it does, it represents these gospel works that are taking place all over the globe. And we know there's a lot of pastors out here this morning, and just pray about what the Lord would have you do with some of these men. But we have several, so I'm going to get out of the way. But the first missionary is serving in a place that we would all like to go for vacation. But let me be honest, to do a gospel work there would be serious labor. Brother Ram, you go ahead and come and tell us what the Lord's doing in the great state of Hawaii.
This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. I want to say thank you to everyone for all the great meals that's been fixed. I want to say thank you to Pastor and Brother Jared for the wonderful meeting. It's truly been an honor and a privilege and a pleasure to be here. I came from Hawaii by background. I'm Canadian-Filipino, born and raised in Canada, and now I pastor Bible Baptist Church of Molokai in Mauna Loa, Hawaii. As soon as you say those words, people think vacation, hotspot. People don't know that at one point in time, Hawaii was the largest Christian nation in the world, boasting the largest Christian percentage per capita in the world, and also had the largest church in the world. What's changed? People started going away from the Lord, and since I've started the church at the beginning of the year, I've been able to lead 19 people to the Lord.
Amen.
We run a church of about 30 to 40 people on Sunday mornings. And people in the town are noticing me. People know me. I'm involved in numerous ministries. I teach a children's Bible study every Monday night. We feed the kids, and we bring kids that have come from broken homes, and then we share the gospel with them. The first night that I taught, 10 kids trusted the Lord as their Savior.
Amen.
I teach at the police station on Wednesdays, and been able to lead the police captain and some of the other men to the Lord over there.
Amen.
You say why? Because God is using and can use anyone who follows him. One of my neighbors who lives across the street says, we've never seen anything like this. A church that started and has already started bringing in people. How do you do it? I said, look at the light above you. You think of all of the man hours, the engineers that have come together to just bring you one light bulb. The men and the women who have really labored, who have sweat, who have rolled up their sleeves to bring you one light bulb. And then you think of how the Bible says, and he made light. He spoke the word simply by saying, let there be light. And God made a perfect and pure light. I went out with the mindset, I'm not going to change people. You young preachers, you pastors, you realize this. You have no bearing and no power to do that. I went in with the mindset of, Lord, I'm going to introduce them to you, and you change their life. And since then, God has done a great work in Hawaii. Why am I out right now? I'm trying to raise a little more support as I'm out there in Hawaii. And I ask more than financial support. I'm asking for prayer support. So if you would, take a prayer card. I have a few prayer cards by the Rochester stand. And just remember to pray for that brown guy in Hawaii. Thank you.
My name is Brother Jeremy Burns, and with me is my wife Megan, my daughter Victory, and my daughter Viola, and my son Ezekiel, and we are missionaries with the Rock of Ages Prison Ministry sent out of the Calvary Baptist Church in Shelby, Ohio. And I accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior in October of 1998 while I was incarcerated in the Souda Juvenile Correctional Facility in Delaware, Ohio. It was the day when I sat in my cell and I picked up a Gideon's New Testament and I turned to the book of Revelation and I read about the sin and death and judgment and things to come. And I sat there as a 15-year-old young man kicked out of school, addicted to drugs and alcohol, convicted of a felony. And it was there that I asked the Lord Jesus Christ to save me.
Amen.
And I know that He did, because the Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved,"
Amen.
Period. And then I got out of that place and I struggled for a long time out in this old world. And I went to the rock and roll churches and I went to the psychologist and I went to the AAs and the NAs. And no one had an answer for me. And for 8 years I wandered in addiction and alcoholism and criminality. And it wasn't until God introduced me to the Reformers Unanimous Ministry at the Grace Baptist Church in Delaware, Ohio, that I allowed the Word of God, I allowed to not be conformed to this world, but I was transformed by the renewing of my mind. And I began to serve my Lord, and I began to go into the prisons, and God allowed me to go back into the very same prison where I accepted Christ as my Savior,
Amen.
In front of the very same cell, and to preach His gospel. And it was there that He called me into the prison ministry, and He called me with Luke 22 and 32, and Jesus talking to Peter, and He said, "And I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not, and when thou art converted, strengthen the brethren." Now Jesus was praying for Peter, He's praying for you and me, and the Bible tells us so in John chapter number 17, that when we get converted, when we get turned around, when we change our mind and we look to Him, that we are to strengthen the brethren,
Amen.
That we are to make our brothers strong. And that is the work that God has given me with the Rock of Ages Prison Ministry, primarily in the state of Ohio. We have 27 adult male prisons with over 50,000 inmates. Our state is at an all-time high because of the drugs and the alcohol. And y'all probably heard about the heroin crisis. Well, the only answer to the crisis is Christ.
Amen.
And that's who we preach in the prisons, wherever God would allow us to go. I ask you, please get a prayer card or visit me and my wife, and we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hi, my name's Tim Sims, and I'm a missionary in the northeast part of Thailand, the city of Khon Kaen. We're sent out of Lighthouse Baptist Church in Walkersville, Maryland, and we too want to thank you for the opportunity of being here and being encouraged this week. It's such a encouragement. We, you know, Thailand's a 99.2% Buddhist, and it's a dark country. And so when you come here to the States, you see the darkness that's here, but there's so much light here too, because
Amen.
Of churches like this.
Amen.
And missionaries and music ministries that we get to be encouraged by, and we're so grateful for that. We've been in Thailand for 13 years. We were in the city of Udon Thani for 6 years, where we helped another missionary, and the Lord in 2010 moved us an hour and a half to the city of Khon Kaen, south to the city of Khon Kaen, where the Lord has used us to plant a church for the Lord Jesus Christ. And we do run small. We're in a storefront, but the Lord's great and mighty and powerful, and He's moving in the people that He's given us the opportunity to minister to. The Lord's used us to plant a bilingual church there, which is not my plan, because that's a lot more work on me to be able to preach in Thai and then have to translate myself into English for those who don't speak Thai. The Lord's doing a great thing with that church there in Khon Kaen. They have they took upon themselves a ministry to go into the local hospital. The hospitals there, the government hospitals, they have an area outside of the hospital where people that are there for treatments, but they don't really need a hotel room, so they stay outside in this makeshift area for places for people to stay. And the church took upon themselves to prepare meals and take over and give out a meal, give out the gospel, and show up Sunday morning and give anybody a ride to church that they want to have, that want to come. And we've seen people saved through that ministry. And we're grateful for the opportunity of being able to serve Him there.
Amen.
Pray that you ask that you please take a prayer card if you see us, and remember to pray for us. And pray for the country of Thailand as the Lord's moving in a great way in the city
Amen.
Of Khon Kaen. Thank you.
Amen.
Well, amen. I'm Brother David East with B-Salt Ministries to the USA.
Amen.
Amen. Baptists seeking souls in America's lost towns. And if you'd agree with me, America's going to hell. Amen. And we need to be about the Father's business. Be Salt is church planting. Praise God. Our director's brother Stephen Sykes, a missionary, church planter in New Mexico. And amen, he's on his second church. And we help rescue churches about to close the doors. Dude, praise God. Y'all know doors are about to close. But you know, churches need to be birthing churches. Amen? Yeah. We need to be doing the will of God. We do operations 1,000 to 10,000. We go old-time fashion soul winning. By the way, soul winning still works. I'm a product of somebody knocked on my door, and I got saved by the good grace of God. Amen. My wife got knocked on the door, amen, and she wanted to die that day. She was asking God to kill her, and somebody had enough God on them to do the Great Commission and come by her way, and she got saved. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Hey, soul winning works, church. Yeah. Let me ask you this, church. Who witnessed to you this week? Did anybody give you a gospel tract? Did anybody invite you to the house of God? Well, I'd like to say, dear church, where's all the Christian soldiers? Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. Be Salt is here to help you, your church pastors. Let us partner with you. My family will come and coordinate a soul winning search. We will map out the area, your communities, and we will simply go old-fashioned soul winning. By the way, we just did one, and on the 900 door, this lady said, "Will you show me how to get to heaven?" And we told her the scriptures, and she got born again, praise God.
Amen.
It still works, amen. Don't you lay down, church, and die,
amen,
because he's worthy of our praise, amen.
Hey,
be Salt. Amen. We got the whole United States mapped out by county. By the way, there's 932 counties in the United States that do not have an independent fundamental King James Bible preaching church. And there's 200 that need more churches.
Yeah.
Christians, let's wake up. America's going to hell. And we have the answer, and we don't use it enough. Let's be about the Father's
business. Amen. Man, I like it when you got so much preach in you. You just can't help it. It's fun. Hey, I challenge you pastors out there, go to www.besalt.org and look up your state. They got it mapped out. And you'll be surprised at how many counties maybe in your own state don't have a fundamental independent Baptist church. This next missionary is a missionary that we have supported for a long time here at Taze Valley Baptist. And I'd like to ask Brother Dr. P.D. Cherian if he would come. He's got South India Baptist Bible College and Seminary. I run into his graduates all over Asia, and they're always doing a wonderful work. And he's going to tell you about a place in Hyderabad that needs a church and has got a man there that's laboring, but they got a specific project. And Brother Cherian, won't you tell him about that?
Well, my testimony is summed up this way. Gospel changes everything. The Lord changed my life in the year 1967. My cousin shared the gospel with me. I remember one of the verses he used from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 8, which tells us, "The unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers, whoremongers, sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is second death." At the end, he asked me, "If you would die today, where would you go?" And I said, "I don't know." Then he showed me from God's word, if I receive the Lord Jesus Christ into my heart, I can be saved.
Amen.
That day, 1967, I asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come into my heart. Amen. India is a heathen country with 1.2 billion people, with 33 million gods and goddesses. I asked the Lord, "What can I do? How can I reach some of these people with the gospel?" The Lord laid the word in my heart to start a Bible college to train young people. 1983, we started the South India Baptist Bible College. To make the long story short, we have graduated over 4,000 students and started over 1,000 churches all across India, Nepal, Bhutan, Tibet, Myanmar, Bangladesh, Thailand, Singapore. Even we have one of the graduates serving the Lord in Red China. We have three schools with 600 students and three orphanages. Now, as Pastor already mentioned, we are trying to help one of our young men started a church in the city of Hyderabad, and people, he is undergoing a lot of persecutions. They are not allowing him to conduct the church in his home. We are praying and asking the Lord. He wrote me a letter and said, an email and said, $9,300 he could build a church that would accommodate about 150 to 200 people. And I would appreciate your prayer for the ministry of the South India Baptist Bible College. In this year alone, we have seen 1,539 people coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior and God. Thank you, Pastor Smith. This church has been supporting the ministry for the past 20 years or more, and I appreciate your hospitality and kindness and all that you're doing for the mission work in India.
How much does that church cost, like do one church like Brother Jared said?
$9,300.
Okay. Amen.
Well, thank you so much, and I appreciate everything.
Amen.
I hope I'm right on this. I think they can build a building for $9,300, and what we're going to do is take up a love offering this morning. Everything that comes in will go to that particular work Brother Cherian talked about, so we can try to get that church building. So, ushers, you come now, and I want my violiners to come up and do another song. Somebody say amen. They're going to sing. They not violin today, they're singing. Okay, I like that too. Lord, you know the need in India. You know the need in every one of these works. But Lord, that church there can be started and continue and really prosper if they can get that building. And Lord, $9,300. God, you raise that up as Brother Cheering is ministering here in the States. God, help us to be a kind of a springboard to help it. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I think all of us would readily agree that the homes in the United States are a mess. Yeah. And so people look at our children and they say, oh, those poor, needy children of Costa Rica. You think they're needy because they don't have the latest gadgets. But you know what? Our children are not needy. They don't need all your junk. Our children have a better home than most of the homes in the United States. And so we're teaching our children that we are blessed, not only because God's people are good to us, but because we have Christ Himself, we have the Word of God, we have a family structure, a mom, a dad. We have so much that God has given us. And so you listen especially to the one line of this old classic song. You'll readily recognize it. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
Up above me, and I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and the Lighthouse family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
Thank y'all so much. Amen.
Amen.
They grow on you, won't they? I like that. Praise the Lord. It's about preaching time again. And Brother Brian McBride's going to preach here in a moment. And I want the old time preachers quartet come and give us a couple songs and take us into preaching. Dr. McBride has really given us something from the Word of God. One verse. And this is his third morning on it. And that's what we're trying to do, is feed you the Word of God and give you the Word of God. And because the Word of God will bring out of you what ought to be out of you. So right now, y'all take us into preaching. Brother Brian, you come and preach here, Mom.
I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for tomorrow. Many times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave blessed consolation that my trials come to only make me strong.
Yes.
I've been to a lot of places. I've seen so many faces, but there have been times that I felt all alone. But it's in my lonely hour, those precious lonely hours, Jesus let me know that I was His own.
Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God.
And I thank God for the valley. Thank God for the storms He brought me through. For if I never had a problem, oh, I wouldn't know that He could solve them. I wouldn't know what faith in God could do. Through it all, I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, I've learned to depend upon His Word. Through it all, I've learned trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. So I thank God for the mountains. I thank Him for the valleys. Thank Him for the storms He brought me through.
Yeah, because He brought me through it.
For if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that He could solve them. I wouldn't know what faith in God. Trust in God through it all, I've learned to depend upon His word. Yes, I've learned to depend upon His word. A long way from home, you feel like the prodigal son, lost in your sin and the trouble within. You feel like all done gone. It just went out the window. You didn't know what to do, but someone stepped in.
Here's the good part.
With the gospel with them, and here's what they'd all say to you.
Finds a sinner on his knees. Somewhere between repentance and faith, that's where He meets our greatest need.
Whatever you've done, wherever you've been,
when you finally come to this place, mercy abounds.
Thank God for mercy.
Salvation is found somewhere between conviction and
you'll find the Lord waiting there.
He's always close as a prayer. Somewhere between conviction and grace, God finds a sinner on His knees. Somewhere between repentance and faith, that's where He meets our greatest need.
Whatever you've done,
yes, yeah, come on.
Wherever you've been,
when you finally come to this place, mercy.
mercy abounds. Salvation is found somewhere between conviction and
good singing. Thank y'all, quartet. Man, they have blessed us ever since Saturday morning. And thank God for them. It is time for preaching again. I can't get too much preaching. I want y'all to know that. And there's two kind of preachers that make me want to preach. Those that can and those that can't. And the one I'm introducing today, he can. Brother Brian.
Oh, yeah. Amen. I was hoping I was in that first category. I wasn't sure. I'm glad to be here this morning. Glad to be at the Taze Valley Baptist Church. We're going to be in the book of Psalms this morning. No, I'm kidding. Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1. It's been such a blessing to be here this morning and this week, and I've enjoyed everything that's going on. I was thinking when Brother Mike was losing his words there, Brother Holcomb, I was singing in a meeting some years ago, and I came to the second verse, and my mind just went blank. I mean, just blank. And I was playing the dobro, and I was looking down at the dobro, and there's a pretty big crowd, and I was trying to find the words, and I'm looking at my dobro, and they thought I was getting blessed. And they started shouting. And, man, people got to crying, and then I did get blessed. Then I got to shouting and carrying on, and we never did finish the song, but the Lord helped us, and we got blessed. But I have appreciated all the work of the meeting. Thank you for all the good food. Thank you for... I got a little cough again this morning. Thank you for the nice place I have to stay. All the kind things have been said and done. I have a few books left if you're interested. I'm running a special. If you buy one of my books, you get one off Brother Milan's table for free. And I appreciate the preaching this morning, Brother Dale. And I appreciated these missionaries. Thank God for these missionaries. Amen. Oh, what a blessing. And these young preachers, amen. I encourage my heart this morning with the preaching. All the singing's been good. These folks did the singing for us. The wandering violinist sang for us this morning, and I appreciated their singing. And then the gospel preachers quartet was a blessing. Everything been said and done has blessed my heart. Now, I'm going to leave, the Lord willing, after the morning service. I had my... Did I tell you I'm a papaw? Did I mention that? I have pictures and videos to prove it. My grandson will be 2 here in a little while, so we had a birthday party scheduled for Friday, and I had a preacher call me who had a little needed some help, and so I've got to go there Friday, so we changed it to Thursday. And I had another preacher call me, and he needed some help, so we changed it to tonight after church. So I'm going to leave tonight and go preach for Brother Sam and my good friend, and then have a birthday party. So I'll be saying goodbye to you, but thank you for everything you've done, and thank you for your kindness to this preacher. In the book of Joshua, chapter 1 and verse 1, we'll read this verse. This has been our text verse this week. Now, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister. There are at least 5 things that we could learn from this verse, and we've looked at a couple of them. The ones that we did not have time for this week, we did not attend the funeral of Moses, where we would have learned that death does not subdue the Lord. We did acknowledge the failure of Moses, where we learned that disappointments do not sour the Lord. We admired a little bit yesterday the forbearance, the planning, the patience of God, and we found out that delays do not stress the Lord like they do us. We will not have time to look at this one. I call it acquainting ourselves with the family of Joshua. And what we would have learned there is that differences do not sway the Lord. You and I have trouble with change. God has no trouble with change. I preached out in Illinois, and a fella there, his first name is Opie, and he's the preacher's son, and he sells tractors. So I went out there one day. I'm talking about those big tractors. And I went out there one day, and there was a tractor, an international tractor, and the wheels were taller than my head. And he sells all that stuff. And so he said, "Would you like to drive it?" I said, I would love to drive it. And so we got in. It had a GPS. You didn't have to steer it. You just turned it around at the end of the field. It had it was enclosed cab. It had AM, FM, stereo, CD. It had air conditioning. It had everything you could want. So we headed down the road. We were going about 40 miles an hour on the road. He said, "Put it in reverse." I said, "Well, don't I need to stop?" "No," he said, "just shift it in reverse." So I reached down, shifted it in reverse, going 40 miles an hour, and it slowed itself down, shifted its gear, and started backing up. It had no trouble with that. I thought about the Lord. He has no trouble with that. He has no difficulty with changing directions. And sometimes it will do you good if you feel like you're not like somebody else, or you can't do what somebody else does, or you don't have the ability someone else has, or you don't have the history that someone else has. You look up Moses and Joshua and see how different they were and how God used them both. I told you we were going to miss this one, but I guess we're not. But God used them both, but it wasn't the differences. It was the same power on their lives that made them usable in the hand of God. And it's not your past. It's not all your abilities. It's not your talent. It's the power of God that makes the difference in your ministry. But what I want to do for a few moments this morning is I want to look at these two words here, Moses minister. I want to use them as our starting point today, and I'm going to call this appreciating a picture or a foreshadowing of Christ. And I'll put it to you this way, and I'll explain it in a moment, and that is that details do not shroud the Lord. Now, I have heard it said, and you probably have heard this statement perhaps sometime. Someone is planning something and they will say, "The devil is in the details. The devil is in the details." But when I read my Bible, here's what I find. The deity is in the details. When I get in my Bible and the closer I look, the more I dig, the more I see Jesus, the more I see how detailed our God is in showing us and revealing to us exactly who the Lord Jesus is and what he's like. I noticed something else. Sometimes you'll get something and it looks good at first glance, but the closer that you look at it, the worse it gets. On our 25th anniversary, the Lord worked it out that my wife and I could go to the Grand Canyon, and we went to the Grand Canyon. I think we're in our 37th year of marriage now, but we went to the Grand Canyon, and while we were there, we went to Nogales, Mexico. We went across the border. I don't think my wife ever let go of my hand the whole time we were in Nogales. And we had people trying to sell us stuff. We've been married 25 years, and they'd come up and say, "Oh, newlywed, you're newlywed," you know, and they're trying to sell us things. And so we looked. Thank you, brother. We looked, and we came in this little store, and They had a purse there. Our girls have always liked Western things, and there were these two little purses that looked like they looked like saddles. And so we thought we're going to get some, but we looked over and we could find one that was real good and one that wasn't in real good shape. And so we didn't buy it, and we headed down. And somewhere along the line, people are always coming up. They say, "You Christian, we sell you nice cross," or "You newlyweds," and so on and so forth. So this fella came walking up to us, and he said he he said something to me in Spanish, and I didn't know what it was, and he held up these two little purses that looked like saddles, and they looked good to me, and he just kind of flashed them at me, told me how much they were, and he was giving me a better deal than what I'd seen in the other store. And so I shelled out the money and took the two little purses, and we put them in the bag and headed home. Well, when we got back in the States and got in our hotel room, we got the two purses out of the bag. I discovered there was a reason why he flashed them at me, why he only showed me one side. When I looked a little closer, on the back side of the one is all messed up. It wasn't all complete. There were things wrong with it. And a lot of times in life, that's the way it is. The closer you look at something, it looked good when you glanced at it, but the closer you looked at it, you begin to find flaws, and you begin to find failures, and begin to find things that are not pleasing. But I have discovered this in my Bible. The closer I look at Jesus, and the more detailed I get about him, he doesn't get to looking worse, he gets to looking better. The more I spend examining him and thinking about him and finding out what he's like, the more precious he becomes. And I have to say, with that little girl in the Song of Solomon, he is altogether lovely. I find no faults in him. So I want to look at some details that we will find here in the life of Joshua that remind us of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I remember years ago, I was in a meeting. Dr. Harold Seitler was preaching, and I know many of you knew Dr. Seitler had that gravelly voice he'd preach in, and he was preaching up there, and I'll never forget him saying this. I've quoted him 1,000 times. He said, when you read your Bible, look for Jesus. You'll find him on every page. And that's exactly what I found. I found him on every page. I found him in the corners, on the top of the page, on the bottom of the page. I found him in places I didn't expect to find him. You know why? Because he said, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. This Bible doesn't tell us everything there is to know about him, but it tells us everything we need to know about him. This Bible is about Jesus. It is the revelation of the Son of God. So I want to preach to you about it a little while. I've got a whole lot to say, and I need to hurry just a little bit. But when we find Moses, we find him as a picture of the Lord Jesus. We find Joseph, our brother preached on Joseph, and the dreamer, a picture of the Lord, how he was beloved of his father, hated by his brethren, how he was exalted, how he was put in a pit and came out of the pit alive and went into a far country and married a Gentile bride and became the breadwinner for his brethren back home and called them and brought them to him. He's a picture of the Lord. David is a picture of Christ in the Old Testament. His name means beloved. He was a shepherd. His father, you know, I'm going to get stuck here if I'm not careful. David's father, Jesse, the Bible said he went for an old man among men in the days of Saul. I call him the Ancient of Days. He may have been the oldest man in the kingdom. And he called for a shepherd's son and sent him down to check on his brethren and take them gifts, and when he got there, they reviled him and despised him. Amen. Who does that remind you of? He came unto his own, and his own received him not, but to as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. And he found his brethren stuck at a place called Evesdamim, which means the border of blood. His brethren were at a place where blood was a problem, and they were facing a man named Goliath, whose name means the exiled one. He was a fellow who'd got kicked out of someplace sometime, and he was standing on ground that belonged to them, and they couldn't have it. And so the beloved went down in the valley of Elah into a trench and cut off the giant's head and came out with the monuments to victory and set his brethren free. He's a picture of Christ. But here in this passage, we find Joshua as a picture of Jesus. And I'm going to mention 3 things about him quickly this morning, and then we'll do whatever's coming next. I want you to notice, first of all, I see the wonderful testimony to Christ in the mention of Joshua by name. The mention of Joshua by name. Now watch, the Bible said, now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun. So the son of Nun tells us that the Lord's wanting a very definite definition of who Joshua is. So it would behoove us this morning to think about Joshua in his name for a moment. Did you know, I'm sure you have noticed this, but I will remind you of it. Did you know that Joshua had 3 names?
He was called, first of all, Hoshea, the son of Nun. Then he is also called Jehoshua, the son of Nun. And finally, Jeshua, the son of Nun. So I would suggest to you that when we come to the name of Joshua, we find a trinity, a threefold name. I want to remind you that our Savior has a trinity in his name, a threefold name, the Lord Jesus Christ. He is threefold in his name. He is also threefold in his nature, because the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost are one in three. He is also threefold in his ministry, our Lord is, because he was the prophet who came to reveal God to me. He was the priest who came to relieve my guilt, and he is the king who came to rule my government, and that meets the three needs in my life. I didn't know God, I couldn't get my sin taken care of, and I didn't know how to run my life. So the first thing I notice is a triune name. Thank God we have a Father, a Son, and a Holy Ghost, the three in one, the Trinity. That's why God said, let us make man in our image. You say, well, Jesus wasn't God. You got a Bible problem, friend. He said, I and the Father are one. Paul said, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached on among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. So, well, Jesus wasn't God. Well, Genesis 1 says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. But John 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And then John 1, and I believe it's 14, said, and the Word, that same word from the first part of chapter, John chapter 1, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, how the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. That's why when the Jehovah Witness shows up at your door, you're not to invite them in nor speed them on their way, because they are of the spirit of Antichrist, because they will not confess that Christ has come in the flesh. And the Bible said he has. He was manifest in the flesh. Amen. By the way, when you think of the title of when the this is not in the message, but when the apostles were preaching in the book of Acts, this was the theme of all of their messages, that Jesus was Christ. Christ. The word Christ comes from the word Christos, which means to anoint. From the word krio, which means to smear or to rub with oil. And they are related to a Greek word kreomai, which means to furnish what is needed. There were three offices in the Old Testament that involved an anointing. The office of the prophet, the office of the priest, and the office of the king. The office of the prophet, again, was to reveal God, the priest to relieve guilt, the king to rule the government. And so we have Christ, the anointed one, who came. He came to reveal God to me. He said, one day they said, the disciples said to him, Lord, show us the Father and it sufficeth us. And Jesus said, have I been so long with you, Philip, yet you've not known me? He that has seen me has seen the Father. He revealed God to us. And then he was the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. He relieves my guilt. And then the Bible said over in Philippians chapter 2, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. He'll have a name written on his thigh and on his vesture when he comes back. King of kings and Lord of lords. He's the Word of God. I tell you, he's the ruler, friend, and he ought to be ruling in your heart. Well, the mention of his name reminds me of Christ. Here's the second thing. Not only the mention of his name, but the ministry of Joshua to Moses reminds me of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is a foreshadowing. He is a minister. Now notice our text says this, Moses minister. I mentioned to you earlier this week that God will use you if you'll be a servant to the servant. If you will serve the man of God, if you will minister to him, God will use you. Well, here is the ministry of Joshua to Moses. If we look on Joshua as the minister of Moses, he is a type of Christ. Now the Bible will say this, he is the servant of Moses. In Romans 15:8, the Bible tells us this of Christ. Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. Now that circumcision is a representation of the sign between God and Israel, and it has to do with the law. The Bible said in Matthew 5 and verse 17, Jesus said, Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, the Bible said, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now, here's what we find out with Joshua. We find out that Joshua was constantly the true and faithful servant to Moses. As a matter of fact, we do not find one time where Joshua failed in his service to Moses. You said, preacher, what does that tell us? It reminds us of this, that our Lord Jesus Christ was the faithful servant of the law of God. We do not find him failing, not in one iota of the law of God. He never did a wicked deed. He never had a shady thought. He never said a word out of place. He was absolutely perfect. He didn't come to destroy the law. He fulfilled the law. Now you think about this, friend. God put a law down. He said to you and I, you must keep the law. And if you don't keep the law, you'll be condemned. But then God said, you know, they're not going to be able to keep it. So here's what I'll do. I'll come and keep the law for them so they won't have to be condemned. When you couldn't meet the demand of God, he came in the person of his son and met his own demand so that you'd never be condemned. We find no failures in Joshua's servant to Moses, and we find no failures in Christ's fulfilling of the law. His father said, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Now, he is not only the servant of Moses, he is the successor to Moses. When Moses' ministry ends, Joshua's ministry takes over. Somewhere between conviction and grace. You see, the law of which Moses is the representative said to me, Brian McBride, you're a sinner. You're condemned. But then Jesus stepped in. And Jesus said, I've got grace. The Bible said this, for the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. And the writer of Romans, Paul, said, and Christ is the end. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. I'm glad today I'm no more under the condemnation of the law. Why? Because of the Son of God who died in my place, who carried my judgment and gave me his righteousness. In the book of Exodus, the children of Israel had come to the Mount Sinai. And God said to them, now if you will obey my voice, ye shall be a peculiar people unto me. He had said to them, ye have seen what I did the Egyptians, how I brought you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. Now if you will obey my voice, ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me. And you know what they said? They said, all that the Lord hath spoken, we will do. The problem is they hadn't done one thing he'd spoken since they left Egypt. And so immediately that God who had just said, I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself, now he says to Moses, put boundaries around the mountain. Don't let them near me. Anybody come near me, they die.
And then he came down in the on the mountain in glory and in power. And you know what the people of Israel did? That same crowd that a minute ago said, you know, I'm a good person. I don't cheat my neighbors. I go to church all the time. I put money in the offering. I've been baptized. That crowd that pretty much said that, now they've seen the holiness of God, and they start backing up. And they start backing up, and they're looking around, and they see Moses, and they say, Moses, we're afraid of God. You go to God for us. You know what that law on Sinai did? It caused them to look for a mediator, and there was Moses, the mediator, who stepped in. I want to tell you something, friend. That's what Jesus did for me. The law said, you're lost. You're on your way to hell. I was raised in church. I thought I was pretty good. But when I saw the holiness of God manifested in the law, and so far away I was, I started looking around and said, must be, surely there's somebody can go to God for me. I was like Job when he said, if there were just a daysman, if there's just somebody in between. And when I did that, the Holy Ghost pointed me to Christ and said, there he is, there he is. He's the mediator of the new covenant. What I'm saying to you is that Joshua was the successor of Moses. The law ended and grace came in. Amen. Then let me say this, Joshua was the securer after Moses. You know what Joshua did? Joshua did what Moses couldn't do because Moses was weak in his flesh. So where was he weak in his flesh? Remember when he smote the rock? And because he smote the rock, there was a weakness in his flesh. That anger, he lost his temper and he smote that rock the second time. And God said, because of that, you'll not enter in the promised land. So Moses couldn't bring him in because of the weakness of his flesh. But what Moses couldn't do because of the weakness of his flesh, Joshua was able to do and bring them in the promised land. Let me read you this. The Bible tells us that the law was weak in its flesh, weak in flesh. The Bible tells us that the law could not bring us into the place of blessing and bring us close to God because of the weakness of our flesh. We couldn't get in. And so what had to happen was there had to be somebody who didn't have any weakness in the flesh. And so that's what Joshua did. Moses couldn't bring him in. Moses could just bring him to the very threshold. But Joshua brought them in, and the law brought me to the very threshold. But Jesus had to bring me in. I did the best I could, but I couldn't be good enough. And so Jesus brought me in. I was given the righteousness of Christ. Under Moses, there were murmurings, there were disputings. Why? Because the law made nothing perfect. But when you get in the promised land, you find them fighting together under the leadership of Joshua. Why? Because grace is what gets you in. Grace is what gets you in. Grace is what gets you in. Law will leave you at the doorstep. So you have a picture of Christ in the name of Joshua. You have a picture of Christ in the ministry of Joshua to Moses. But finally, you have a picture of Christ in the mission of Joshua for Israel. Now, this is about Joshua and the land, because Joshua is all about the land. It's all about getting what God has promised you. And so they're going to set their foot. God tells Joshua, every place you set down the sole of your foot, I've given it to you. If we only knew the things that were ours in Christ, if we'd only just appropriate them, if we'd only just start walking with Jesus and find out what it really is that we have as a Christian. Amen. I want you to notice the beginning of securing the land. Where did it start? Where did Moses or Joshua's public ministry start? It started at the Jordan River. That was the gateway into the promised land. It's a picture of death. And it started there. Joshua begins to do all that God has told him and appropriate the promises of Christ, of God, right there at the banks of the Jordan River. That's where his public ministry as the leader began. Can I ask you a question? Where did the public ministry of Christ begin? It began at the Jordan. You know what I like? Joshua said, the Lord said to Joshua, said, pick you out to 12 men. What did Jesus do when he started his ministry? He picked him out 12 men. And they're going to cross that river. Right there at that river, right there on the banks of that river, is where God put his stamp of approval on Joshua. Well, right there on the banks of that Jordan River, the Bible tells us that John was baptized, and we talked about that a lot. But one little phrase we miss, that the people came to John confessing their sins. So John's in that Jordan River, and they're confessing their sin. Now, think about it. I'm afraid to go up there and preach where them other fellas were because I'm old and I get dizzy. But John the Baptist is baptizing, and they're confessing their sins. So here comes a woman walk up. She said to John, "John, I've been a harlot. I've been immoral. And I'm sorry. I repent. Will God forgive me?" And John baptized. She brings forth fruit for repentance. Some fellow walks up and he said, "I've been a thief. I've cheated my neighbors. I've cheated my business. I'm so sorry, John. Will God forgive me? How can I be forgiven?" And John baptized him. Another one comes up and confesses this sin. And another one comes up and confesses that sin. Another one comes up, and they're all in line there. They're all in line confessing their sin. And then all of a sudden, the next in line, all of a sudden, John looks up and there's somebody in line. And John looks over at him, and John's waiting, but he don't have no sin to confess because he's the spotless, sinless Son of God. And he's standing in line with sinners who have been confessing their sin and saying to John, "How can I be forgiven? How can I be clean?" And John sticks a bony finger out and points it at Jesus and said, "There he is, there he is. That's the Son of God. Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." You want to know how to be clean? There he is. You want to know forgiveness? That I'm glad he lined up with me at the Jordan River. I'm glad he took his place with sinners, even though he was sinless and pure and clean. The beginning of his ministry was there at the Jordan. Not only the beginning of his ministry, but the battle of his ministry. You know what happened to Joshua immediately after crossing that river Jordan, that being a public ministry? He went into battle. And for a long time, he fought the enemies of God. You know what happened to Jesus immediately after being, oh, by the way, I forgot. While he was on that river Jordan, while he was standing there, and while he was there and he got baptized by John, you remember what happened? The heavens opened. There was a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." And the Holy Ghost in the form of a dove rested down upon him. You think about that dove, friend. Last time we heard about that dove flying anywhere was back in the book of Genesis. Noah was in the ark. He sent out a raven. That raven lighted on those dead bodies because a raven's a picture of the old nature and it likes corrupt things. That Holy Ghost dove, it never did light because it doesn't like anything corrupt. It kept looking around for some place to land. Never could find a place to land because it never could find a place that didn't have any corruption. It flew over all those Old Testament prophets, all over those Old Testament saints. Good men they were, but they were still flesh. But one day that Holy Ghost, I come flying over the river Jordan, and up out of Jordan came a man in whom there was no sin and no corruption. And after John said, "That's him," the Holy Ghost said, "That's him," and the Father said, "That's him." Then the Bible said he was driven of the Spirit into the wilderness. He started the battle. That's what Joshua did. He started the battle. And he won the battle. You know how he won it? "This word of the Lord shall not depart out of thy mouth. Meditate on it day and night." How did Jesus win that battle out there in the wilderness? "It is written. It is written. It is written." You know how you win the battle? It is written. It is written. It is written. It's not just quoting the verses we heard this morning when Brother Michael preached. It's being subjected and in submission to the truth of the Word of God. And if you are, you know, the devil would look at Jesus and say, "Now," and Jesus say, "It's written." He'd say, "Well," and Jesus would say, "It is written." He'd say, Jesus would say, "It is written." You know why the devil couldn't bother him? Because he knew he just didn't know the verse. He knew what to do with the verse. He was submitted to the verse. He was submitted to the will of his Father in heaven. I heard a charismatic preacher say one time, he was in error about a lot of things, but he said this one time, he said, I tried that business. He said, them Baptists will tell you to use the word of God and it'll defeat the devil. He said, I tried it and it doesn't work. I'll tell you why it didn't work. You got to do more than quote it. You got to live it. You got to do more than speak. You got to do more than have it on your mouth. You got to have it in your heart. Are you listening now? As a lot of folks put great emphasis on what comes out of the mouth, but it's the heart that makes the difference. And what comes out of your mouth is awful shallow if it didn't come from your heart. Amen. So he went to the battle. There was the beginning of his ministry. The battles of his ministry reminds us of Christ and the blessing of his ministry. Because you know what Joshua did? He divided them their portions. Joshua said, here's what you get. Here's what you get. Here's what you get. That's what Jesus does with us. Here's what you get. Here's what you get. He gives us our portions, but he gave us something else. The Bible expressly tells us about Joshua and rest. And the Bible tells us Joshua didn't give them all the rest, but it says this in Joshua 21, and the Lord gave them rest round about. How did he do that? He did that through Joshua. But we get to the New Testament, and here's what the Hebrew writer said. Again, he limiteth a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus, this is talking about Joshua now, for if Jesus had given them rest, then he would not have afterward spoken of another day. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. So what he's saying is Joshua gave them a picture of the rest that Jesus gives to you and I. We may be in the battle, but we're still resting. We may be going through the trial, but we're still resting. You said, preacher, what are we resting in? We're resting in that wonderful, amazing grace that God has given us. And no matter what it looks like, we know what the end will be. We know how it's going to turn out. We know we're kept by the power of God. There remaineth therefore a rest unto the people of God. Now, what will we do with all of this? What will we do with all this business of this picture of Moses' minister? Well, it ought to remind us, first of all, of the design of Scripture. That this is not a book that came about by happenstance. That this is not what several men wrote what they thought, but it is holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. That all Scripture, listen to me now, I don't hear preachers saying this much anymore, but I still believe it. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. All of it. Amen. I'm holding in my hand, are you listening now? The inspired, infallible, inerrant, preserved Word of God. And so I'm saying to you, we ought to be reminded of that today. We ought to be reminded of the design, that there is a hand behind it, that it is all, it's not just a collection of writings. It's not just what men thought about God. It is what God thinks and wants us to know about his son, Jesus Christ. You can trust this book. You can build a life on this book and a home on this book and a ministry on this book. You can stake your eternal destiny on what this book says. It ought to remind us also of how detailed our Heavenly Father is. He's interested in the smallest detail of your life. A fella said to me one time when I asked him about something, I wasn't getting after him, I just asked him a question. He said, you think God cares about that? Yeah, I do. I think he's interested in every detail. He said, Jesus said in the book of Matthew, every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. He's interested in every detail. He is a detailed God. And you know, I use that to remind us how we ought to be careful, but it ought to bless us and help us. God doesn't overlook any detail in your life. No need, no question, no hurt, no heartache. He doesn't overlook any of it. He is detail-oriented. And then it ought to remind us of this, of the dearness of the Son of God. that God the Father would write this book so that we might know him through the person of his son. And I'm going to tell you, the most important person you will ever know is the Lord Jesus Christ. And you and I ought to spend our life learning more about him, walking with him. The old songwriter had it right when he said, more about Jesus would I know. That's what we ought to do. That's what our life ought to be about, that we might know him better and know him more. And I'm going to tell you, nearness is likeness. And the closer you get to him, the better you get to know him. The more you'll be like him. The less time you spend with him, the less you'll be like him. And so we ought to spend a lot of time with him, talking to him, sharing with him, reading about him, getting to know him. Amen. You know, sometimes I think we treat salvation like it's the end of the journey. Okay, I got saved and that's it. No, it's the beginning of the journey. It's the start of a brand new life. We want to go on. We want to know him better. We want to progress. We want to be more spiritual. We want to be more like him. We want to be more pleasing to him as we go along. And then we ought to be reminded, since God wrote this entire book about Jesus, of the desperate need of the world. What do they need? They need to know Christ. They need to know the Lord. I've been preaching out of Psalm 144, seven things that'll steal the happiness of a nation. You look in there sometime. He talks about pacifism and anarchism. He talks about he alludes to transgenderism. He talks about socialism, David. He talks about multiculturalism and globalism. And he talks about humanism. And he talks about, in that passage, he warns us about atheism. But he ends up and he said, blessed is that nation that is in such a case. Blessed is that nation whom God is the Lord. And he said, my king, my strong tower, my righteous. He said, you know why I think this way? Because I know him. Because I know him. You're going to go to work and people don't know him and they don't know right from wrong. And you're going to try and make them do right when they don't know the difference between right and wrong. And what they really need is to know him. And if they knew him, it would make a difference about everything else they think of. If they just knew him. That's the desperate need of the world, is to know Christ. I want you to bow your heads a moment. Your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed. Someone's going to come to the piano. Let's stand to our feet a moment. If you don't know the Lord, won't you come trust him today? He loves you. He cares about you. He wants to make a difference in your life. He wants to give you rest and peace and joy, make your life profitable spiritually in every way. He wants to help you. But I tell you, the best thing is, if you know him, you'll just find out he's precious. He's precious. I remember I had a very dear friend who loved to fish. Greatest, I like to fish myself. He's the greatest fisherman I ever knew. His problem was sometimes he'd go fish instead of going to church. He was a Christian. Something happened in his life. And I went to see him not too long before he died. And here's the way he talked. I'd never heard him talk this way before. He said, I asked my sweet Lord. I'd never heard him say that. Later on, he said, I talked today to my precious Lord. I went there one day, and he said this to me not long before God took him home. He said, I asked my sweet Jesus to let me lead a soul to Christ, to him, before I died, and he granted that request. You know, he'd spent a long time learning how to fish and knew more about it than anybody I knew. But something happened in his life and he got more interested in Jesus than he'd ever been before. And the more time he spent with Jesus, he couldn't call him Jesus anymore. He had to call him my sweet Jesus, my precious Jesus, my wonderful Lord. Oh, that we would know so much about him and spend so much time with him that we couldn't speak his name without telling somebody how precious he is and how sweet he is and how wonderful he is and how good he is and how much he means to us. Father, help us now. Help your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Our sister's going to sing. If you need to come, you come this morning.
Nothing's working in my church. Oh, there's one thing will. Point them to Jesus. I said, preacher, I got somebody that's hard. I want to see something happen for them. Point them to Jesus. We need to know more about Jesus. Sing just a little bit more, Lord. The altar, we'll be mindful of that. Brother Jared's going to come in a moment and give you some final announcements and remind you about the book tables and all that. I'm going to be leaving a little bit. I probably won't be up to lunch. Michael Hayes, here's your job, okay? It's been my job up until today, but your job now. If you get this one wrong, probably going to be bad for you. Miss Smith is there at the house trying to recuperate from her knee. She's been here every night. You're going to go up there and tell the kitchen help, you know, get her plate, and you're going to take it down to her. You can eat first, and then you take it down to her. Would you do that for me? Because I'm going to forget about that because I'm going to have to go. And here's what I want you to do for me. I've got to go to a doctor's afternoon and then maybe another one. I'm having a major surgery on Monday, a knee replacement. You said, how you know it's major? Because I've already had one of them. And it's awful. And I do have some complications because my heart's still a little bit. I deal with my cumin, they got to deal with some other things. So you pray for me, especially Monday. Will you do that for me? Pray for me Monday when I go to surgery. And I'd appreciate that. So I'm going to be going a lot this afternoon, and you pray for me as I'm traveling. All right, Brother Jared, finish your house.
He schedules his surgeries, his vacations, He schedules everything around what happens here. I want y'all to know that. We love you, preacher. And make a way, make a path like Moses across the Red Sea for Michael when he's going to get that food. Because really, if he messes up, we might not ever see him again. It's true. It's true. Oh, life or death. With fear and trembling, I would fulfill that mission. Oh, it's been so good. I just want to remind you, those that are here this morning, maybe you missed what happened here Sunday, the powerful preaching and the singing, or maybe you weren't here Monday or Tuesday. We have got all of that recorded, and we'd love to offer it to you. And if you go back here to where the book tables are and all that, and you see the lady, she's got a little desk set up there, and just tell her what services you want, and she'll get you copies of those. And if you're in a hurry, you just stop by our website here in a few weeks, and we'll have everything available on there, our YouTube channel, and all of that. So just keep that in mind. And I do remind all of those that are here for the first time, we won't have a meal provided after the service this evening. So get all you can this afternoon. All right. Let's go ahead and ask the Lord's blessing on that food. Yes, sir?
I was just kidding about Brother Milam's book tables.
Just kidding about the book tables. But you could try it anyway. All right. Let's make a deal. Let's make a deal. Amen. All right. Well, let's pray. Father, it's just your children again thanking you for speaking to us. Lord, I pray that we haven't just heard you, but that we've listened to that word. Lord, that we wouldn't just let it go in one ear or bounce off the first ear, but Lord, that we would apply it to our lives. Lord, help us now to take Jesus to our homes, to our churches, to those other nations represented in here today. Bless this food and bless the fellowship that follows. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.